In my previous video, I mentioned how I destroyed my SKR 1.4 motion control board while running my servo at 24 volts. This is the follow-up video to talk about what happened and what we can do to protect our motion systems from a fiery death. First, let's talk about what happened. I was running the speed test with my servo at 24 volts and it was chugging along happily. We can see tiny voltage spikes during braking, but it never exceeded 25 volts. Since the power supply can handle 36 volts easily, I decided it was okay to skip the regenerative braking protection. Ah, silly me. When the test continued with the 500 gram load, something blew up. Okay, it wasn't quite so dramatic, but there was a pop and the unmistakable smell of failure. So I took a look at the SKR 1.4 board and found an obviously dead IC with massive craters on the package. According to the SKR 1.4 schematics, it's the DC to DC converter. And looking up that datasheet, I found its absolute maximum input voltage to be 31 volts. Okay, I guess the 7 volt spike seems plausible. The SKR 1.4 board has jumpers that allow me to bypass the DC to DC converter and power the board with USB instead. Of course, it didn't work. Well, it turns out I actually blew far more than just the DC to DC converter. Among the other casualties are the voltage regulator, a tantalum capacitor, something I'm guessing was a fuse, and finally, the microcontroller. So, while the SKR 1.4 is taking a break, let's talk about how we can all avoid this mistake. To do that, it's useful to have some context on what regenerative braking is. Instead of focusing on the theory, which has already been covered extremely well by Jensen Lee on YouTube, let's run some experiments on the bench and see what happens for ourselves. The simplified explanation for regenerative braking is that a spinning permanent magnet motor becomes a generator. It's true, but it isn't the full story. Let's have a look. We'll use the simplest possible setup, a DC brushed motor with a half bridge made with buttons and diodes. We'll be running all our experiments with the power supply set to 12 volts. I've attached a 500 gram weight to increase the rotational inertia so the motor continues to spin for longer. The half bridge on the breadboard is configured as shown in the schematic. To drive the motor, I'd use switch 1, which is the top button. The oscilloscope is configured to show the motor and supply voltages, and will trigger when the motor is driven. Okay, let's get to it. Pay attention to the current being drawn. Notice that it starts high and decreases as the motor spins up. This part is vital in the explanation of regenerative braking, so let's pause here for a moment. As the motor speeds up, the voltage induced by the permanent magnets on the motor coils, the back EMF, increases. The back EMF counters the drive voltage, which is why the current drawn reduces as the motor speeds up. When the motor reaches its maximum speed, it means the back EMF has completely cancelled out the drive voltage, so there's no current, which means there's no torque, which means there's no acceleration. When I release the button, the motor is disconnected from the power supply, and we can measure the back EMF, and see it decreasing with the speed. And there we go, we're not driving the motor, and we still see a voltage. So it's a generator. Since we see a voltage, we can extract energy from it, right? Not so fast. Without any external forces, the back EMF will never exceed the supply voltage. So we wouldn't be able to get current flowing from the motor back to the power supply. This means this isn't regenerative. And if there's no current flowing, the motor is just freewheeling, so it's not braking either. It took over 30 seconds for the motor to come to a stop. As it turns out, the motor being a generator is only half the explanation for regenerative braking. For the other half, we need to get the motor and driver to become a boost converter. If you don't know what a boost converter is, it's like a bait and switch. Let's pick up where we left off with the schematic. The motor is freewheeling and the back EMF is measurable across the motor terminals, but there isn't any current flowing. For starters, we want some current to flow. We do this by pressing switch 2, shorting the motor terminals. The back EMF then causes a relatively large current to flow in the reverse direction, resulting in the braking torque. In our bait and switch analogy, this is the bait. Let's first verify this works in practice. Note the change from switch 1 to switch 2. The motor comes to a stop in 10 seconds, compared to the 30 seconds from before. Now that the current's gotten going in the motor, which is an inductor, it cannot stop instantaneously. So we take advantage of this and do a switcheroo, the second half of our bait and switch analogy. We disconnect the motor terminals, and since the current needs to keep flowing, it goes through the diode and back into the power supply. So there we have it, regeneration and braking. Let's try to do this with our manual setup. I've set the oscilloscope to trigger when the motor voltage exceeds 22 volts, much higher than the 12 volt drive voltage. The spike's going to be extremely brief, so I've set the time division to 100 nanoseconds. With the motor spinning, we tap on switch 2 to short the motor terminals for just a split second, and the oscilloscope captures the tiny voltage spike. The peak motor voltage we see is about 40 volts, substantially higher than the original drive voltage. The supply voltage also spikes to above 30 volts. Since the inductor wises up to the bait and switch in under 1 millisecond, we'll just have to repeat this at a few kilohertz and we are golden. There's an excellent breakdown of this process on Stack Exchange. I've put a link in the description below. Okay, now that we understand what regenerative braking is, let's go back to the servo and have a look at the voltage spikes. The servo is the same one that killed the SKR1.4 motion controller. It uses a C3548 hobby BLDC with a custom controller and custom firmware. We'll talk about this circuit board later. It isn't doing anything just yet. The oscilloscope's time division is switched back to 100 milliseconds, and it's set to trigger when the supply voltage exceeds 20 volts. The power supply is still at 12 volts. Okay, we're gonna do this. Don't blink or you'll miss it. Did you catch it? Alright then. How many revolutions did a servo just make? The answer is 2 revolutions. Trust me, I'm an engineer. Alright, here's some proof. The move, including the settling time, takes just 0.2 seconds, kinda like a slowish blink of an eye. Anyway, the oscilloscope shows that the supply voltage spiked to about 24 volts, nearly double the drive voltage. With an actual load and a higher speed, the spike could contain enough energy to damage the power supply and other equipment attached to it. Fortunately, there are circuits we can use to redirect the energy from regenerative braking to someplace safe. When I was figuring out a solution to this problem years ago, one of the circuits I came across was the returned energy dump circuit published on Gecko Drive's website. It comes with a nice summary of why you need it and how it works. The only problem is that the drive current has to flow through D1, which contributes to power losses. Another method is to have the motor controller detect the reverse current and actively control a shunt. This is the method the original open source O-Drive uses. However, for my pick and place machine, I wanted a protection circuit that was independent of the motor controller. So I made one myself. And here are the schematics. Ignore the stuff on the top. That's just the inrush current limiter. The circuit is a shunt regulator, and the design is centered around the TL432 precision programmable reference. I followed the typical application circuit for using the TL432 as a comparator, and simply made the input adjustable with a trim pot. The output of the comparator goes to an inverting gate driver. The component used here is actually a half-bridge driver, but I'm only using the inverting side. The gate driver switches the low side N-channel MOSFET, which shunts the power supply rails through the braking resistor. D1 is a flyback diode, just as a precaution. Finally, I've put in a resistor that adds a bit of hysteresis, which should reduce the switching frequency. If you want to find out more about hysteresis, there's a nice article on Wikipedia. This is what a PCB layout looks like with all the components on. For regenerative braking protection, we're only concerned with these. And this is what it looks like in real life. And here it is, hooked up for testing. I've stolen the massive braking resistor for my pick and place machine for testing. It's an extremely overkill resistor rated for 300 watts. For this test, the protection circuit is adjusted to activate when the supply voltage hits 13 volts. The oscilloscope shows the supply voltage, same as before, but the second channel shows the protection circuit's gate source voltage, which tells us when the braking resistor is switched on. Okay, we'll be doing two revolutions, same as before. The oscilloscope shows that the protection circuit is working as expected. Comparing the captures side by side, the protection circuit appears to have constrained both the spike's magnitude and duration. Repeating the test with a smaller time division, we can see the effect of the hysteresis, leaving us with a nice sawtooth wave. That's all I have for today. If you've watched all the way to the end, thank you. I'll be making more videos on the servo and some of my other projects, so remember to subscribe and leave me a comment if there's something specific you'd like to see. Thank you for watching, and see you next time.